to thine own self be true. These words were uttered by a doting father, Polonius, to his son Laertes in Shakespeare's play Hamlet. It is a maxim and credo, Ek sabga abud, imparted to his sons Mario and Norman, which they live by to this day. Born in Syria in January 1930, Ek Abud came to Trinidad when he was just 8 years old. His father had died, so Ek in 1938 was sent to Trinidad under the wings of his uncle Abdu Sabga.
Our actual last name, our legitimate born surname, was Abud. We are descendants of the Abud family, and my father, when he migrated from Syria to Trinidad, was taken under the care of Abdu Sabga, who was the elder of the Sabga family, who was very prominent in Trinidad. And he, my father's mother, and him were brother and sister. So he took my father under his wing and he educated him. And out of respect for Uncle Abdu, my father, upon graduating from law school in England, he took on his name. He joined the Sabga name with the Abu name, and that's how we have Sabga Abu.
When he returned to Trinidad from law school, AK threw himself into his chosen profession. In 1957, he became a councillor for the city of Port of Spain and was then deputy mayor from 1959 to 1960. AK was appointed as High Commissioner to Guyana in 1963 and then to Jamaica in 1966. In December 1961, AK was appointed a senator to the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago and served from 1961 to 1966. A true national with deep roots to his adopted homeland, AK made valuable contributions in the Senate during the debate on the Appropriations Bill 1962, where he cautioned the nation to keep up with the times and union leaders to act in the interest of the nation with integrity and responsibility. We see around us today, Mr. President, all economic theories and all economic barriers crumbling. We must keep up with the times. We cannot afford to lag behind. 40 years ago, the Russian Revolution struck upon us, and all our economic alignments were changed, our political philosophy, etc. Today, Britain, long considered the market for West Indian products, is seeking entry into the European Common Market, and I dare say the repercussions of that entry will have equal, if not greater, ramifications when that time comes to pass, insofar as the economy of this country is concerned. We must, Mr. President, not only watch, but prepare for it when it comes. It is hoped that our trade unions and their leaders wouldn't follow the unwarranted and contemptible example of some of our merchants and shopkeepers and use these proposals as an opportunity to profiteer. I have every reason to believe that they can be depended upon to act in the national interest and, like some of their counterparts in other parts of the world, thereby set the example of national integrity and responsibility. In the end result, Mr. President, the bounty that is to be reaped from the harvest from these proposals shall be theirs to benefit and enjoy, and I commend this bill for the acceptance of this House. Also, in the budget debate on January 25th, 1963, Sabga Abud was passionate about the passing of the bill for the development program, especially the need to develop a sewerage system in Trinidad. Mr. President, what I am saying is this, that there's a dire need for a sewerage scheme in Trinidad and Tobago, and that has been the subject of debate both in this Senate and in another place. And no one in his proper mind would contend that there's no need for a sewerage scheme in Trinidad and Tobago. No one, knowing what the situation is in Belmont and Lavantil, and having seen the cesspits and the filth that exudes there, would say a sewerage scheme is not absolutely and positively necessary in Trinidad and Tobago. Surely, if there's typhoid in the country, it ought to be eliminated, and not by doing away with the sewerage scheme. You do not cut your nose to spoil your face. By all means, if there is typhoid, eradicate it. Do all that is necessary to eradicate it. But do not tell me seriously that anyone in his right senses would contend that the sewerage scheme is not an essential necessity for the health and well-being of the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. Provision is made, and rightly so, for the continuance of the sewerage scheme. I should have thought that the senator would have said that the sewerage scheme has not gone far enough and that it should be taken further. I would have agreed with him, provided that the necessary funds were made available. By all means, extend it further and further. Curtail it? Never. And in the income tax debate on April 14, 1964, he challenged the government on its accountability. I think it is an insult to ask a question and put it in Latin as if it would cover the disgrace of it any better. Government have set up themselves as custodians of the public purse. But who is to guard the custodians? Who is to guard the custodians indeed? The Attorney General said he never anticipated that this would be a constitutional debate. But indeed it is aspiring to be one, because the Constitution makes it quite clear as to who are the custodians of the public purse. Senator Aboud was relentless in his efforts to pull Trinidad and Tobago into the future. His tenure as a senator coming to an end, Ake was appointed Trinidad and Tobago ambassador to the Middle East and had the pleasure of presenting his credentials to President Assad of Syria, President Anwar Sadat of Egypt, and the Shah of Iran. He held his ambassadorial post to the Middle East until his death in 1975. Ake was married to Maria Lakis on the 14th of September 1959 and had four children, Mario, Jackie, Lorraine, and Norman. Clearly, he was a devoted husband and father, whom his sons Norman Sabga Aboud and Mario Sabga Aboud said influence their lives even today.
I think for me the one quality that my father has instilled to me is his name. His name to him was always very, very important, and he told me that. And he always told me as a little child, he says, his father died with just a chaplet. That's all he had, and that chaplet is worth more to him than anything else in the world. He says, son, always remember, I don't have much money to leave you, but what I'm leaving you is your name, and please cherish your name. And I've always looked back at that and always remembered that my name is very important. And many times I have signed my name to a document, and I could have backed out because I was going to lose a lot of money. But I always remember what my dad said, and I've never ever turned back since then.
My father has a lot of memories in my life. He actually influences us, I think, on a daily basis, although we lost him at a very young age. I was only 9 years old when he had died, and it was probably the most traumatic experience I've ever had in my entire life. And it changed my life, and I believe my entire family's life going forward, in that you immediately had to mature very quickly at a young age. But in the time that we knew him, he imparted to us a lot of qualities and a lot of messages that we use in our day-to-day life every day. And so he's always part of our lives, no matter how old we were when he died.
AK knew he was dying, but kept it to himself. He impressed on his children the values that he wished them to have as men and women.
I see my father and myself so much every day. I try to emulate what my father is, so much so that my son tells me I'm crazy. I always tell my son, he's 23 years old, I always tell him how much I love him, and I'm always very affectionate. I'm always hugging him up. We go out for dinner and I'll hug up my son. He says, Dad, I'm 23 years old, stop hugging me up. But I've always tried to instill that love that I did not get totally in my life, because my father left me when I was a young age. In fact, I've tried to create such a bond with my son that while he was away in school for 6 years, every single night before I go to sleep, no matter where I was, I would talk to my son. We would always share a good night with each other before we went to sleep. And he gave me this little stuffed toy, because I like stuffed toys. And I always go to bed with it. I always travel it wherever I go, so that my son is always next to me. And my dad taught me that, the importance of family. Very, very important, family, and the love that you have for your family, your mom and your dad and your sisters.
To this end, AK wrote a poem to his sons.
The greatest legacy that my father left to us was that he imparted to my brother and myself a lot of ideals by which to live our daily lives. He had a poem that we found after he died, and that he had written, and it spoke volumes, and it still does, because since I've graduated school, for the last 25 years, I've worked with my brother. And we share everything, we do everything together, and we have a very close working relationship. In the poem that he left, I think that will probably be the best way to describe it, simply says, "My sons, I have two coins to share. The whole I give to Mario, the whole I give to Norman, and yet the whole of it I keep. I could give half to Mario if I choose, or I could give half to Norman if I choose, but then the whole of it I lose. My sons, the solution to this riddle you will find when both your heads you keep combined." And to this day, we have always done that throughout all our lives. I respect him, he respects me, and all the decisions that we make, we really make together.
Ake died at the early age of 45. His sons look back on his life and wish to thank him for being a wonderful father.
If I could ever speak to my dad and he could listen to me right now, I think I'll tell him, "Dad, thank you for everything you've done for me. Thank you for the way you raised me. And I love you very much, and I'll always be there for you, Dad. And I'll always think of you, and hopefully one day we will both meet."
If I had to tell him something now, I would say I love you. I think at 9 years old, I did not know what love was. And I would have to say, growing up, seeing my own children have taught me probably how he saw us. And, you know, hearing my kids say the word "dad" means so much to me now, because I never really, after the age of 9, I never really had the opportunity to say the word "dad." So whenever they call me "dad," or they pick up the phone, or they text me "dad," just that word "dad" means so much. So I would like to say, "I love you, Dad."
Trinidad and Tobago also thanks A.K. Sabga Aboud for being a loyal son of the soil, and indeed for his service to this great nation. A.K. Sabga Aboud, an outstanding parliamentary personality.